Hello everybody and welcome back to my channel. This is part two of the Susan Powell video. This is gonna be followed by one more part. I wish I could do more parts. There's so much to this case that I wanted to share with you guys. However, I'm leaving for Cape Cod on the 17th of this month and I'll be gone for a week. It's a little vacation with my kids and my in-laws, so it's gonna be a nice getaway before the kids go back to school. So I can really only do three parts for this, but if you are interested in more, and who wouldn't be, because this is a crazy case, you should definitely go check out the Cold podcast. It did such an amazing job. I am so in awe of the investigative journalist who put together this podcast. This was done after years of research and talking to people and looking through police files and records, and he did such an amazing job. So if you're interested in all the nitty-gritty details and things that I wasn't able to fit into these three parts, please go check that out. Rosie's not feeling good today, so she's a little attached to me. Before we get started, I want to give a quick shout out to our sponsor for today's video, which is Hunt a Killer. Hunt a Killer is one of my favorite sponsors to work with because it is so much fun. It's such a fun service to use, and I just got my new box, so I wanted to give it a quick open and show you guys what's inside. So with Hunt a Killer, you solve one case over multiple boxes. This is the third box I've gotten in regards to one case, so I'm really excited, and they send you such cool stuff so that you can put together all the evidence and solve the case at the end. And every time you get a box, you put more and more of the pieces together. So I have this evidence bag, and inside there's a pair of socks, and they have aliens on them. So I'm excited for these just for my real life. This is everything. And you have this envelope in here, and this is gonna have like all the police files, letters, things like that. So I'm gonna pop this guy open. Oh, I hate ripping envelopes like this. They look so neat and orderly, and then I just destroy them. So once again, we have a letter from Gray Investigations. They've been helping us with this case. And we also go in here and we have all sorts of information. Looks like there's some checks here. There's a medication list, all sorts of stuff that I literally cannot wait to go through and start adding it to my murder board so I can finally, hopefully, solve this case. Oh, there's some pictures in here. There's some autopsy pictures. I think there's two boxes left in the season because there's six boxes to a season. So I know I'm not gonna probably be able to solve the case. When you think you've solved the case from like the first box or two, then you'll get the other box and it'll give you evidence that leads you away from who you thought it was initially. So it's so much fun. It's not easy at all. I thought it was gonna be easy because I feel like this is kind of what I do. And I was like, I'm gonna be able to put these pieces together really quick, but it's been so challenging. But so fun. Nev and I love doing it together, and I'm so mad that she's moving into her dorm next week because I feel like we're gonna have less time. I'm gonna have to like bring my murder board to her dorm room, and then her roommates are gonna judge her. If you guys are interested in joining Nev and I on this amazingly fun journey, you can use the code and the link in the description box, and you can get 20% off of your first box. I really suggest at least trying it out. You will see once you get started that it is so addictive and so fun, and you don't wanna stop. It definitely is something that I feel like you can do alone, but I think it's more fun to do with like a spouse or, you know, your daughter, as long as she's old enough to understand and not be scared. Like, don't do it with your 9-year-old daughter, maybe an older child, a coworker, a friend, a parent. It's just a lot of fun to do together because even when you're not actively looking at the clues and building your murder board, you're still always talking. Like, I'll always text Nev and I'll be like, whoa, I just thought about something about this case. Like, what do you think? And then we'll talk about that and it gets this dialogue going and it's just so fun. And it kind of is a game that seeps into your everyday life where you're always thinking about it and you're always trying to solve it. So guys, if you're interested, use the link in the description box. Use code Harlowe, H-A-R-L-O-W-E, to get 20% off of your first box, and let's get started on the video. So when we left off, Josh and Susan Powell had made the decision to leave Washington State and leave Steve Powell, Josh's father, behind because he was getting seriously creepy. And he was kind of not respecting the boundaries of their marriage and not respecting Susan's boundaries in general. In December of 2003, they arrived in Utah, and for a little while they stayed with Josh's sister Jennifer and her family until they could afford their own place. It didn't take long though, because the next month they purchased their first home. It was a 2,200 square foot home on Sarah Circle. Here is how Josh felt upon the purchase of their first home. This is a direct quote, and I'm not quite sure why he is referring to himself in the third person in this quote. That's a whole nother puzzle to unravel, but here it is. He says, quote, "He had several misty-eyed moments as he contemplated the workings of the Spirit. Also, the greatness that this house could bring to Josh and Susan. No longer would they be transient and subject to whatever unsuitable shelter came available. No more clutter and lack of access to their property. No more getting angry every day because of these factors." Once again, like I said, the third person thing is very strange. He doesn't seem to have done this often in his journals. He almost seemed like he was writing a book about it, or as if he was watching it happen from outside of his own body. Susan settled happily into her new life. She was making friends at church, at work, and in the neighborhood, and she was excelling at her job. But it seemed like Josh wasn't the only person she'd told about Steve Powell's creepy behavior. She told his daughter, Jennifer, as well. And Jennifer didn't have a hard time believing that her father was capable of such things. She also told a new friend of hers named Kersey. She and Kersey became very close, and they were together several times a week. Susan told Kersey that Steve Powell was the reason they'd left Washington State to begin with. While Susan worked, Josh felt that he had too much potential, and he was too good to work some entry-level job. He'd been working at a temp job doing data entry, but before they even moved into their new house, he'd been fired. This placed an incredible amount of pressure on Susan, who now became the household's sole provider because Josh had decided he wasn't going to go back and get a traditional job. He was going to become a real estate agent. But he wasn't going to be a real estate agent who worked for somebody else. He was going to like start his own real estate company and work for himself from home. Susan wrote about her feelings during this time in her journal. "Maybe Josh will get a client so he can start making an income, or will get pregnant. Either would be great. I feel like I'm too stressed out, working a temp job and supporting a mortgage with no job prospects for Josh." Susan was working, volunteering at church, and trying to sustain a marriage. Josh spent his days and nights sitting and playing on his computer and talking to his family for hours on the phone, usually on speakerphone. Susan said that his family would be on the phone with him all day long. He would just put them on speaker and then put the phone down, so it was almost as if they were in the room, but nobody would be talking for long stretches of time. So sometimes she would walk in and start speaking to her husband, and he'd be like, "Oh, you know, I have my dad on the phone," or "I have my brother on the phone," because they would just be sitting there on speakerphone while he was doing whatever he was doing on the computer, which struck Susan as very odd. Number one, she didn't like the fact that Josh was still communicating so much with Stephen Powell after what had happened. Number two, she didn't like the fact that she couldn't walk into a room in her own house without knowing whether or not she was being listened to. Susan did become pregnant, and in June, with Josh still not working, she was given a full-time position at the temp job that she was working at, which was good because it came with more money and it also came with medical benefits, which she would obviously need with the pregnancy. While all this was happening and she had her plate pretty full already, she also studied for, took, and passed her stockbroker's license. So she was a very motivated, hardworking young woman. And I guess she would have had to be, since she witnessed for herself every day how little Josh did and how little he wanted to do. She gave birth to their first son, Charlie, on January 19th, 2005. When she went into labor, Josh was working on something on his computer, so her parents had to drive her to the hospital. He ended up showing up at the hospital about an hour later, but he still had his computer with him. And while she was having contractions and going through labor, he sat in the hospital room and was on his computer. At one point, Chuck Cox, Susan's father, had to walk over and physically shut the computer and say, "Go and be with your wife." Those who were close to the couple and knew about Josh's immaturity and lack of dependability thought that becoming a father would change him. A lot of these same people had thought that him finding a good woman and getting married would change him too, but that hadn't, and becoming a father didn't really make an impact on his personality and his work ethic either. He kept spending money on things that he wanted really bad, but he didn't need, and he gave the bare minimum amount of time and attention to his son and wife. When he forgot their fourth wedding anniversary, Susan vented in her journal. I am depressed and stressed because Josh wants me to possibly go back to work again and doesn't seem to want to focus on real estate. And the church is covering our utilities and our groceries, and I feel like a mooch. And like Josh just wants to take the easy way out and never get around to supporting his family. So obviously this is written when Susan is on maternity leave, and instead of stepping up to the plate and saying, you know, you are a mother now, and if you want to spend time and stay home with your baby, your new baby for a little while, then you should be able to do that. And I'm going to go get a job so that I can pull my weight with the financial burden and you can feel a little safer and more comfortable to spend as much time as you need to with our new child. He didn't do that. He wasn't devoting his time and energy to his real estate company. He wasn't devoting his time and energy to going out and finding a job that would bring in real money. He wasn't doing anything to the point where they had to accept financial assistance from the church. They weren't having sex either, and Josh gave multiple excuses for this. First, he said that they couldn't afford to have another baby. And second, he said that he didn't want to get sick. First of all, yes, it's probably true that they couldn't have afforded to have another baby, but the Mormon church is not against contraceptive. Some people believe in their faith that you're blessed with a child when it's supposed to happen, so they don't use contraception. But with the Mormon church, it wasn't like that. They didn't tell them that it wasn't allowed or you couldn't use it. They left the family planning up to the families. So they could have used contraception and they wouldn't have gotten pregnant. And secondly, this whole thing, this paranoia about becoming sick with physical contact, it didn't start with Susan. Here's what she said about it in her journal. It's been almost a year since Josh and I have been physically close, as in sex. Josh always seems to be stressed out or busy on the computer or too tired by the time he gets to bed. Or he's worried that he'll get sick by kissing me or that we'll get pregnant again, despite the fact that you can't get pregnant just by kissing. And I think it's common for a couple's sex life to change once they have a child. Some men begin to look at their partner as a mother and they have a hard time coming to terms with this, but typically they do overcome this and they resume their normal sexual activity. But to this extent where he didn't even want to kiss her for fear of getting pregnant or getting sick, where did this come from? His ex-girlfriend Catherine cited similar behavior from him while they dated. She said in the beginning it was normal, but after a while he didn't want to kiss her anymore because he was convinced that he would get sick. Josh claimed in his audio journals that he wasn't into kissing or cuddling. He said he could cuddle with his partner for a second, but then he needed to get away in order to maintain his comfort zone. So once again, put yourself in Susan's shoes, and your husband all of a sudden doesn't even want to touch you. You haven't been together sexually for over a year, which is a long and extended period of time for a married couple to be celibate for, to say the least. Not only that, but he doesn't want to get a job and help you out with the dire financial situation that he's pretty much responsible for putting you in. And he talks to his father, who sexually harassed you, constantly. As a man who was depending on his wife to pay all the bills, take care of their son, and do all the cleaning and cooking, he should have been bowing down to her when she came home from work every night and rubbing her feet until she fell asleep. But he wasn't. He couldn't even be bothered to kiss her. And everybody's entitled to their own preference. Some people don't like physical intimacy. Some people don't like public displays of affection. But to marry someone and have no problem, seemingly, with kissing and sex and cuddling and affection, and to all of a sudden flip that switch and not want to have any physical contact with them, it's not fair to the person you married because you've pretty much trapped them under a false set of pretenses. You've told them that you were somebody that you're not. People need to feel loved and accepted and desired by their significant other. And if they're not getting that, it causes feelings of depression and loneliness and isolation. Josh was also a pack rat, and he kept everything, every piece of paper that ever came his way, that he ever laid hands on, he kept. And then he basically stored them in boxes until he got around to scanning them into his computer to the point where he had enlisted Susan to start helping him scan these things into the computer. He was controlling with Susan just as he had been with Catherine. Susan had written about her high school boyfriend in her journals when she was in high school. She wasn't writing about him as an adult, but she'd written about him while she was in high school. And of course, during all his free time during the day, Josh had read her journals and he told Susan that he basically wanted her to write her ex-boyfriend out of her life, that he didn't belong there anymore and he wanted him out of the journals. And Susan refused because once again, like I've said in the past video, the reason that Susan was encouraged to keep a journal for so long was so that her future descendants could learn from her mistakes and her wisdom as she went through life. So she wasn't going to edit her life or lie about her life or change things just because Josh wanted her to. He also wanted her to get rid of her prom pictures, any pictures of her with friends or boyfriends that weren't him, he didn't want in their house. To Susan's credit, she pushed back and she refused to do these things, which I'm sure agitated him to no end. It was clear at this point that their marriage was not a good one and Susan was desperately trying to fix it. She wrote Josh a desperate letter, grasping at whatever was left between them. "I want this marriage to work, not just for Charlie, but for us, because Charlie will grow up just like you did, and I still want to be with you after Charlie grows up. Just like I'm sure your mom and dad wish they had a significant other in their lives now that you kids are all grown up. I will keep working at Fidelity, keep not spending money, only gas. I'll only drive to and from work and daycare. I will not do hair or only do it when you tell me you won't be home or I can do it at someone else's. I can continue to try to scan. I can read scriptures out loud for us. I can continue to say prayers and make a continuous effort to make our marriage work and us be happy in it." This was a woman who was making sacrifices and was willing to make these sacrifices to make her life harder and more complicated and make sacrifices in order to make his life easier. A woman who was desperately scooping water out of a sinking boat, and she was the only one who had been making sacrifices and making an effort in the past, and for her to be so in love with him and so dedicated to her marriage and her vows and her family, to continue to make all of these crazy deals with him. "I won't do hair," or "I'll only do it when you're not home," or "I'll try to do it at somebody else's house." So what, she wasn't interrupting him from his long conversations with Steve Powell on speakerphone or his surfing the internet for, you know, cat videos? What else was he doing? Because he wasn't working. He didn't need a quiet house to focus or dedicate to his job. And it just breaks my heart to see her trying so hard and laying herself bare in front of him and knowing that she got nothing back, that he didn't even care, not only about what she was doing for him, but the sacrifices that she was making for him. He didn't care about their marriage. He didn't care about her. In May of 2007, Susan was pregnant again. They had to take out a second mortgage in order to stay afloat. His real estate business, of course, was bringing in no money. On top of that, he was being sued by a debt collector and he ended up owing over $90,000 that they now were responsible for paying off. It was the absolute wrong time to be having another child, but Susan still happily anticipated the arrival of her next baby, hoping that it would be a girl. Just under 2 years after the birth of his older brother, Brayden was born on January 2nd, 2007. By this time, Susan was also jobless, and they had two children now and a mortgage. Josh was still trying to make his real estate business work, but of course it wasn't, and it wasn't going to, so they filed for Chapter 7 bankruptcy. At this point, Josh was over $200,000 in debt. Although Susan was still putting forth her best effort, her journals really showed how discouraged and just sad she was becoming. She said, quote, "I made dinner, which I'm the only one enjoying, and I'm sitting here reading a self-help book thinking nobody appreciates my efforts, or at least not the people I'm closest with to make an impact with, like Josh. I'm not suicidal or anything, just feeling alone and frustrated, which is interesting because even as I write feeling alone, I know I'm not alone, and I'm aware how blessed I am, and almost feel selfish to want to pray for improvements, but I still want things to be better than they are. And in reality, it's probably Josh who should have been reading that self-help book. Nobody's perfect, but Susan was doing her very best to be a good wife and a good mother. And like she said, she felt that her efforts were just being overlooked and discarded without care. At the end of 2007, Susan began to look for full-time work again. Somebody had to, even though she had two children now that Josh really wasn't interested in helping take care of. She had to get a job, and luckily, she found a full-time position at Wells Fargo. Things should have been looking up, but once again, her journal entries from this time are absolutely heartbreaking to read. As I'm kneeling on the kitchen floor, cleaning up the food from the boys, all three of them eating, I had to make an effort to concentrate on why I'm better off being married as opposed to the single mother I often feel like I am. I had to stop and think about if Josh had died, if we were divorced, if he were the original guy I married, what would be different and how much better that would or wouldn't be? Decided I don't want him dead. I like him around for the boys. Occasionally, he actually does what I need him to do. And I obviously can't speak for men, but I think that this is a feeling that so many women often experience. She felt as if she was running herself ragged and he was doing nothing. Right here is where love dies, where you feel like you no longer have a partner, but another burden. When you feel as if you have given and given up everything you have and you are, and you're left completely empty because you've handed out everything inside of you, but nobody's given you anything back. This is where resentment begins and thoughts of what life might be like after this person that you're married to. Those thoughts start to creep in because you already feel like you don't have a partner. You already feel like nobody's helping you. You already feel like you're doing everything on your own. So why should you be doing all of that, but still have somebody else telling you what you can spend and where you can go and what you can do? And when these thoughts begin to creep in and the resentment begins to build, there's usually no going back from that. To add insult to injury, Susan arrived home the evening before her 27th birthday to find her house an absolute mess. The kids' toys were all over. Josh had baked her a birthday cake, but it sat on the counter, unfrosted, and there was cake batter everywhere. There was dirty dishes in the sink. There was literally cake batter on the cupboards, on the floor. Everything was trashed. And she walked in, and he was sitting at the computer watching clips of Saturday Night Live. And he told her that now that she was home, she should probably frost her own birthday cake. She didn't frost her own birthday cake. She started cleaning up the kitchen and picking up the toys and trying to set her house right again. Now, nobody should have to come home to a wrecked house. And I understand that after you have two small kids running around all day and you put them to bed, you just want to chill out. But you still have to respect the person that's been gone all day and at work all day and understand that they probably don't want to walk into a sink full of dishes or cake batter drying on the floor of the kitchen. Nobody's expecting Josh to have the house looking immaculate, but the least he could have done was clean up after himself. She was most likely thinking, no, this can't be it. An unfrosted cake on the counter, this can't be my birthday. He'll have something planned for tomorrow. But the next day was not much better. Josh gave her a secondhand dry erase board, one of those calendar boards where you can write on appointments and birthdays and stuff and you put it on your refrigerator. She described it as basically yellowing around the edges as if he'd picked it up from a garage sale. 2 days later, they went to Jennifer's house to celebrate Susan's birthday with Jennifer and Terry. And Josh handed Susan a small box, and once again, her spirits rose, and she was like, okay, this is it. This is my real gift. And inside were some DVDs that he had gotten from church. Cheap plastic whiteboard and DVDs probably cost a buck each, she wrote to her friend in a Facebook message. In this Facebook message, she also went over a list of gifts that Josh had given her throughout the years. He'd given her chocolate, stuffed animals, a glass vase filled with fake flowers, and a peridot necklace. Now, he gave her this necklace in Christmas of 2006, and peridot is an August birthstone, and Susan, she wasn't born in August. She wrote to her friend that the necklace must have been on clearance. He must have gotten it really cheap because who wears a peridot necklace when they don't have an August birthday? She went on to say that the cake mix and the frosting probably cost more than her actual birthday present and ended the message saying, wow, I'm bitter. Now see, it wasn't about the money for Susan. She didn't care how much money he spent on her gifts. It was about the lack of thought and attention. See, Josh was cheap, but he was also materialistic, if that makes sense. If it was something that he wanted, there was no expense spared. Computers, hard drives, RC cars, cameras, camcorders, but for everything else, he literally pinched every penny that he could. He made Susan bargain hunt and clip coupons for groceries. If she bought yogurt that was 5 cents cheaper at another store, he would go into a rage and ask why she had done something so stupid. If she spent too much on something, or what he considered to be too much, he would berate her and then lock her out of the account, the bank account, which all the money that was going into that bank account was money she had earned from her job. So it was no wonder that in 2008, Susan considered filing for divorce. She said, "I feel like a prisoner in my own family, fighting to practice my own religion and beliefs in my own home. I can't believe our marriage deteriorated so quickly. I feel so blind and naive and foolish. I cherish my boys, but realize they'll grow up and move on." Josh finally got a job designing a website for a trucking company, but you know, he didn't want to work for anybody, so this was freelance work. And then he started his own web design company called Polish Marketing. And of course, this company didn't do anything, didn't make any money, didn't get any jobs. But he wasn't not successful because he couldn't do the work. He'd actually become very adept at designing websites and doing things on computer. Hell, he spent his entire day and night on the computer. So he had taught himself how to do these things and he was very good at it. It was because he didn't want to dedicate the time and energy into making this a successful business venture. Even though he was making basically nothing and Susan was making the bulk and the majority of the money, her paychecks were deposited into the bank account that she had no access to. Remember I said one time she spent too much money at the store and he'd cut off her access to their bank accounts. So she didn't know how much money they had. She didn't know what was going in or coming out. She made all the money, but had no control over it. She secretly opened a separate checking account and she deposited small amounts of money in there when she could, and she used this account to donate to her church because Josh refused to let her spend any of the money that was in the actual bank account to donate to the church. She used this money to make sure that her kids had enough food because Josh was real stingy in what they were able to buy at the grocery store. And she used this money to pay her parents back a loan of $3,000 that Josh and Susan had borrowed from them years before. And that when they had declared bankruptcy, Josh decided he didn't have to pay it back anymore. They shared a car, and when Josh started working, he would either have to drop her off and pick her up from work, or she would travel the 15 miles to and from work on her bike. I mean, I know that biking to work is good for the environment and healthy for you, but can you imagine having to get up in the morning, get two kids ready, up and fed, have to get yourself ready, and then bike to work every morning and make it there on time? Like, what time would you have to get up and how stressed would your mornings be to make sure that you gave yourself ample time to integrate a bike commute into your morning? It's just insane to me that a man would make his wife bike to work while he took the car. Now, she wanted to bike to work and that was her choice and this was what she decided to do for her health or whatever. That's one thing, but she didn't like doing it and she didn't want to do it. And she had to travel dangerous highways and certain areas where it was very isolated and anything could have happened to her. They fought about the normal things that people fight about, money mostly. Susan wanted Josh to do more to pull his weight around the house, help with the kids, maybe do a load of laundry every so often. And also they fought about their quickly diverging religious beliefs, but it was constant and explosive. Susan wrote in a Facebook message to a friend, "He's mainly emotionally, verbally, and financially abusive. Basically, I'm a single mother with this guy who lives with me and dictates to me what I can do in my spare time and takes my paycheck and spends the money." When their arguments turned into counterproductive shouting matches, Susan would try and walk away, get out of the house, or take a walk to clear her head. But she was only human and had a bit of a temper herself. Once she slapped him, and he pretty much told her, "If you ever do that again, I'll hit you back." Her friend that she was communicating with on Facebook asked her if she was scared that he would do something to her. And she responded, "He's justified that if I'm yelling in his face or hitting him, that he thinks no matter what other men of authority think, it's okay to hit me back. So yes, that's always in the back of my mind. But lately, I've even picked up the phone and said I'm calling 911. and he takes the phone out of my hand, or immediately backs away and tries to make me look like the crazy, irrational one. Now let me be very clear, I don't think that violence is acceptable on the part of anyone, man or woman. If your relationship has escalated to the point where one or both parties feel the need to be physical, that is the time when you need to walk away and reevaluate if this is right for you. I don't like this perception or the idea that a woman can hit a man and that's okay, but it's not okay for a man to hit a woman. Of course, it's never okay for a man to hit a woman, but I don't believe that women should be hitting men either. Susan did not just confide in others that her marriage might be ending. She created a paper trail. On June 28th, 2008, she took out a piece of lined paper. On the top, she wrote, "Last Will and Testament for Susan M. Powell. I am at work at Wells Fargo Investments. I bike to work daily and have been having extreme marital stress for almost 3 to 4 years now. For mine and my children's safety, I feel the need to have a paper trail at work, which would not be accessible to my husband. We've been to a church class about wills, and I know he can override me with the legal paperwork, but I want it documented somewhere that there is extreme turmoil in our marriage. He has threatened to skip the country and told me straight out if we divorce, there will be no lawyers, only a mediator, and I will ruin you. I, Josh, would be ruined too, but you would be destroyed and your life would be over and the boys will not grow up with a mom and dad. If something happens to me, please talk to my sister-in-law, Jenny Graves, my friend, Kiersey Hollowell, check my blogs on MySpace, check my work desk, talk to my friends, coworkers, and family. It is an open fact that we have life insurance policies of over $1 million if we die in the next 4 years. Coworkers, family, and friends have heard me say this occasionally. I want my marriage to work out. I've told my husband he is depressed or has issues, and we as a family of four are not happy and not showing how a husband and wife should interact, that we are messing up our children. He doesn't want to go to counseling and says if I were to buy groceries for cheap sale prices, those prices don't exist now with the cost of gas going up, that he would be happy with this well-purchased bargain deal food in his stomach, and maybe our marital problems would be solved. He also said he's mean to me because of the Republicans, direct quote. Then he mentioned something about how terrible our economy is because of Republicans, and if that were fixed, then we wouldn't have these problems. If I die, it may not be an accident, even if it looks like one. Take care of my boys. I want my parents very involved and in charge of their lives. If they aren't there, my sister can hopefully be responsible. I love my boys. I live for them. I choose not to cheat or do drugs because I wouldn't want to risk losing them." On the side of this note, she wrote, "I love you," to her sons. "I'm sorry you're seeing how wrong/messed up our marriage is. I would never leave you." She folded this piece of paper. She put it into an envelope that she created out of another piece of paper and wrote on the outside of this envelope, "For family, friends of Susan, all except for Josh Powell, husband. I don't trust him." A month later, she made this video.
This is me. July 29th, 2008. It is 12:33, mountain time. Covering all my bases, making sure that if something happens to me or my family or all of us, that our assets are documented. Hope everything works out and we're all happy and live happily ever after as much as that's possible. And I am documenting all our assets just in case of any emergencies, fire, flood, damage, disputes. And we have 2 Samsung monitors. And this is Josh's computer and there's some type of backup device and speakers. And here's the kind of pimping out stuff he's done to his computer. He built it himself. I think there's like 5 hard drives, something about doing raids. There's those for all the computer geeks. Josh locked this, but this is all of his files. See? Locked. Those are his files. And he bought expensive stuff like these are, I think this was like a couple of $1,000s. Of like, it says graphic design templates by stock layouts or something like that. Alright, here's our unfinished basement. We bought 3,000 pounds of wheat, and these are buckets of wheat. See? So there's a whole bunch of boxes of, or buckets of it. Here is a rigid saw. I don't know the difference is, I think this is a chop saw. Oh, there we go. It says miter saw utility vehicle, MSUV. And there is a shop vac. It's all stuff bought in a year or less through Home Depot on my credit. Josh bought a lot of stuff and then he had to bankrupt it. And then he bought a little bit more on my credit. Oh, there's his RC car. It's pretty pimped out. If you can see that stuff. I think he's got probably a 3,000 worth of supplies in the RC car world. Whole lot more tools. So we brought drill sets. Here's a nail gun by Boss Stitch. Here's a rigid small drill. A Milwaukee drill. A rigid, I think that's a sander of some sort. Here's another rigid saw.
Mommy.
This is all of Josh's RC car stuff. You are with me. I'm told it's like worth $3,000. There's more RC car parts. Yeah, we got that rigid step ladder. There's some fans. Okay, now we're upstairs. Here's another saw, or I mean drill. Here's another RC car and remote. Here's a laptop. This remote, I guess, is like $300. Justified by a babysitter to be able to run our TV. Speakers, 5.1 surround sound. AIWA is the brand. 5-disc CD or DV, I don't know, stereo system. We added these lights. Chandelier. Josh claimed that was a birthday present, I think, for me. Hover Storm, he bought a stupid hovercraft remote control toy. This is a can organizer that Josh is and I made. I had to help him all through the way. He doesn't do projects by himself. This is Josh's welding machine. Here is, I think it's a bandsaw. All expensive stuff that we bought. A lot of it got bankrupted. A lot of it got added afterwards. This bike I paid out of my Wells Fargo account. $489 was with the fender. Here's the rest of the 3,000 pounds of wheat. And tools galore. More tools galore. These are all the paperwork of the tools he bought. Clamps, tools, measuring tape. Our scratch and dent furniture that we got from RC Willys when we moved in the house 2004, like March, April. This is a $3,000 rocker glider. My parents lent us the money for. We still owe them, I think, $3,000. No, wait, that chair was $300. We owe them $3,300, and we owed them $4,200 or something like that. Now we are left standing owing $3,000. Josh felt the need to pull the mirror out and cut more holes in the wall. Said he was going to make shelves. That didn't happen. I like to do Mary Kay, but it's expensive, so Josh always cuts me off after a while. Almost forgot. Remember that camera we saw in the box in the garage next to the hovercraft? Here it is. Nikon digital. A little stand. And obviously what I'm shooting this off says JVC. Hard disk camcorder, micro S, HD, 30 GB, 7 to 37 hours, 4 recording modes, hybrid, Everradio, Konica Minolta lens.
It was a video that a lawyer had recommended she make. It went over all of their belongings and assets, and it showed just how expensive Josh Powell's habits were. There was cameras and camcorders and treadmills, RC cars, things he had purchased while he was making her watch every penny she spent to provide for their family. When she had asked him why he could spend so much on these things and she couldn't spend anything on anything, he told her it was none of her business. She was bracing herself for a separation of assets. But even through all of this, she was still trying, and this would remain true until the very end. Maybe that is why, on February 4th, 2009, Susan agreed to go with Josh to a lawyer's office and sign papers that said if Susan died, Josh would have control of her assets. If they both died, Steve and Michael Powell would manage the assets jointly for Braden and Charlie until they turned of age. But if only Susan died, Josh would have the power to erase her father as a trustee. She also signed papers granting Josh power of attorney over her retirement accounts. But surely it would be absurd to think that Josh would make sure he had all this power and control just so he could off his wife and make a financial profit. Normal people don't think this way. Well, it just so happens that one of the few things that Susan and Josh had in common was their love for true crime. They really enjoyed watching crime television programs together. They binge-watched seasons of 24 and CSI, and Josh would get very analytical about why the perpetrator of the crimes had slipped up and gotten caught, what he would have done differently if he'd been the one doing the crime. He wasn't shy talking about this either. One of Susan's friends stated that one day she was at the Powell home, and Josh was watching a news story about a recent murder. He casually said that getting away with murder wasn't hard. He could do it. All he'd have to do was make sure the police couldn't find the body. He also repeated these kinds of statements at a work Christmas party for Susan's job at the end of 2008. He was telling a husband of one of Susan's co-workers that the shows had it all wrong. People were always getting caught because they didn't get rid of the body properly. If it was him, he would take the body out to the West Desert where there were lots of abandoned mines and drop it down a mine shaft. It would be the perfect solution because mine shafts are unstable and, quote, if you knocked a little of a shaft loose, it would all come tumbling down and no one would really want to travel down it because they're unsafe. And listen, it would be hypocritical of me to say who thinks like that, because I think like that. I think we all think like that a little, right? People who are interested in true crime are analyzing things that murderers do, why they did it, what they may have done differently, how they would have gotten away with it if they hadn't done this. And I'm not gonna sit here and tell you guys that I haven't thought about ways to, you know, dispose of a body without it ever being found. That's just because I'm into that kind of stuff and the forensics and everything, not because I plan on ever doing that. But the point is, because we think about that stuff, we can share it with each other because we know that we're all on the same page. But I wouldn't go to my husband's Christmas party and sit there with his coworkers and say, yeah, if you want to get rid of a body, just throw it in a mine shaft and then like knock a little bit of the shaft loose because they're dangerous and people don't want to look in there and then nobody's ever going to go in there and find it. Like, it's easy. That is a little like on the outskirts of what's normal, even considering what we think is normal. Susan often had to speak with Josh about how he didn't really consider his audience when talking about things, that he would go on and on and on for hours about something that interested him and not give that person a chance to get a word in edgewise or give that person a chance to redirect the conversation to something that interested that person. Josh was pretty clueless when it came to people not being interested in what he was saying, and he hated when people disagreed with him, especially about politics. So if he was ranting and raving about politics and somebody inputted their opinion, like, well, I don't necessarily agree with this, he would just talk loudly, talk over them, and get upset that they didn't see it his way, and then try to basically bully them into seeing it his way. In early 2009, Josh began bargaining with Susan. If he did certain things for her, then she would do certain things for him, like signing away her life. Although Susan had never lost her faith and passion for the LDS Church, Josh had stopped going, and she believed that it was due to the influence of his father. It really bothered her that he didn't want to go to church anymore. It really bothered her that he would say things to her and basically make her feel bad about what she believed in, just as his father had done to his own mother so many years before. So when he offered to go to church once a month, she felt like she had won something. He also told her, hey, they could start trying to have another baby, which she had been pushing for and he'd been resisting. Susan desperately wanted a little baby girl, and if she got pregnant again, she was hoping that it would be twins. And it may seem counterproductive to want a baby so much at this point, to want to bring more children into a world where your marriage is at the worst possible place. But Susan's kids were her life, and they were her only source of affection and love. On a lot of days, they were her only source of happiness. She wrote in an email to a friend that she had been telling Charlie multiple times a day that she loved him. Just randomly, she would look over at him and tell him that she loved him. She wanted him to feel loved, and that probably stemmed from the fact that she felt so unloved. And she was so happy and excited when he started saying it back, when one day, randomly, he just looked at her and started saying, "I love you, Mom." She said it was the only time that she felt loved. In the summer of 2009, a couple of things happened. First, Susan thought that she was pregnant again. She excitedly purchased a pregnancy test only to have it come back negative. Secondly, Susan finally had gotten Josh to do something around the house. The deck needed to be rebuilt and the basement needed some work done to it. Josh got the lumber, he was good at chopping, and he dug some holes. And then that was it. That was pretty much all that he accomplished himself. In September of 2009, he was rear-ended. It was a small fender bender, but he claimed afterwards that he had all this major back pain from getting rear-ended, and he couldn't complete the deck on his own, and he had to buy an incredibly expensive massage chair. He told Susan he had whiplash, and he began seeing a chiropractor and taking muscle relaxers. So, you know, of course, it was right where he needed to be, where he was like this injured baby bird that needed to lay in a massage chair all day while taking muscle relaxers and not do anything. Susan wrote an email to her sister saying that she hoped the purchase of the massage chair would help Josh's back enough so that he could continue work on the deck. Josh was not a physical person. He didn't exercise. He didn't particularly like any physical activity. And basically, I mean, pretty much he was just lazy. He was a lazy person. A neighbor who ended up helping Josh finish the rest of the deck told the Cold podcast, "My 11-year-old daughter could lift more than he could." And he wasn't really trying to be mean. I don't know if Josh just wasn't capable of doing it, like he wasn't strong enough, or he just was lazy. He didn't want to do it. And many people said this about Josh, that he would avoid doing physical work at all costs, but he would have no problem enlisting other people to help him and then directing them how to do it and making sure that they did it in the way that he would do it himself if he had the motivation to do so. The neighbor that helped with Josh's deck said the whole deck project was incredibly frustrating, that Josh couldn't physically help him lift anything. And on top of that, while this neighbor finished the deck pretty much all by himself, Josh stood there and told him exactly how he wanted it and where he wanted it and was very controlling about how it should be completed. While his neighbor was basically building the deck for him and Josh was sitting there like drinking Mountain Dew, he bragged about how he had cheated the system by buying all these incredibly expensive tools, like power tools, the works. He had all top of the line stuff, but he cheated the system by buying that and then declaring bankruptcy. So he pretty much had gotten them for free. And his spending habits had not changed even after having to declare bankruptcy, being so in debt and having the slate wiped clean. He just continued to rack up debt. He bought that expensive massage chair in September. He bought a rug doctor and a gas torch in November. And while he was focused on buying all these high ticket items that he didn't apparently need, and apparently there was no need for, by November of 2009, he and Susan were still married and still miserable. And Susan was still feeling ill. At first, she insisted she must be pregnant, that the test she'd taken had to be wrong. She was nauseous all the time. She was exhausted. After she had been nauseous and exhausted for an entire week, she went to a doctor to get blood drawn to check for a pregnancy test. And that pregnancy test with the blood had come back negative as well. A few of her friends thought she should go back and get more blood drawn to check for other conditions besides pregnancy. And even though we haven't talked specifically about Stephen Powell for a while, he was an ever-present factor in the life of Josh and Susan. Remember I said that Josh would always be on the phone with either his sister Alina or his father Steve or his brothers Michael and John, and Susan would sometimes walk in on these conversations or overhear pieces of these conversations. One time, she heard Josh on the phone with his father. And both boys were sitting on his lap. So Brayden and Charlie were sitting on Josh's lap, and Josh, while on the phone with Steve on speakerphone, was telling his kids their mother was evil for making them go to church, but that they didn't really need to go to church or even listen to her. Susan began to believe that Steve Powell was the puppet master. Josh had progressively become meaner to her, condescending, dismissive, cold, judgmental, would outright say horrible and rude things about her religion and what she believed in, trying to make her feel bad about believing in it. Steve had already turned Josh against Susan, as he had turned Josh against his own mother years before. And now, the two of them were continuing the cycle by turning Susan's own sons against her. This was clearly something that Susan could not wrap her head around and was hard to forgive or understand. In March of 2009, Susan had made a decision. Josh had a month to show some actual change, or she would be filing for divorce. Susan wrote to a friend, "I don't expect an overnight change, but I also don't think I should waste another couple of years while the kids grow up." But that deadline came and went, and Susan thought he was showing some subtle changes, and that's what Josh Powell did. He would act oblivious to what other people were feeling, but that wasn't true. Josh was actually very intuitive to how other people were feeling. He just didn't care. But when it benefited him, he could sense how other people were feeling and he would use it. Josh sensed that Susan was pulling away and he gave her breadcrumbs to feast on. And as a starving person does, she gobbled up those breadcrumbs and sustained herself on them. A rare trip to church or an out of the blue "I love you." It's sad when your husband says, "I love you," and you're like surprised by that. You're like, "Whoa, he just said he loved me." But that's exactly how Susan felt when Josh would tell her that he loved her. These things kept her hanging on. She wrote a friend saying that unless he was beating her, cheating on her, or hurting her or the kids, anything could be worked out. And then she began excitedly preparing for Christmas. But it would not be worked out. It could not be worked out. And Susan Powell would not be around on Christmas morning to see the happiness on her son's faces. The morning of December 7th, 2009 was snowy, with a winter storm headed into Utah. It was a Monday morning. Susan and Josh should have been headed to work, and Brayden and Charlie should have been getting dropped off at daycare. But that morning, the two boys did not arrive at Debbie Caldwell's house. She called the Powell home, and when no one answered, she called Susan's office phone. But that call went unanswered as well. Finally, she called Josh at work, and they informed her that Josh had been a no-call, no-show that morning. Debbie had to drop some of the other kids in her care off at school, so while she was out, she decided to drop in on the Powells and make sure everything was all right. A few inches of snow had fallen overnight, and when she pulled into the driveway, she noted that there was no tire tracks or footprints in the fresh snow. Debbie was worried that maybe the family was still inside and suffering from a carbon monoxide leak, so she called Susan's emergency contact, Jennifer Graves, Josh's sister. Jennifer drove over to the Sarah Circle house with her mother and her kids, while Terry called 911 from the car on the way. This call was made at about 9:53 a.m. The police were there by 10:02. They found the house securely locked up, and there was no response to several knocks on the door. Basically, with the condition of the house, the police assumed one of two things. Either the family was in distress inside the house, or they had not been in the home all night. They called in backup, and by 11:30, they had broken a window to gain access. Inside, they found the house empty, but there were several signs that it had been recently occupied. A stereo was on, the boys' toys were on the floor, and there were two box fans blowing on the carpet and couch, which were still damp. The minivan was gone, but Susan's purse was still there, with her money and her driver's license inside. Jennifer claims that this was the moment she thought Josh might have done something to Susan. And for his own sister to immediately reach that conclusion within hours of Josh, Susan, and the boys being missing says something about Josh Powell. The weather conditions weren't great, so the police went through the usual protocol of checking to see if the van had been in an accident or if any of them had been admitted to a local hospital. When they called Josh and Susan's cell phones, they went straight to voicemail, which strongly suggested that the batteries had either died or they'd been shut off. By early afternoon, when there was no sign of the family, a detective was assigned to the case. Detective Ellis Maxwell arrived at the house and got filled in by the patrol officers. He walked through the house and determined that although it didn't appear as if there had been a struggle or a robbery in the home, there was still something off about the whole situation. He placed the family and their vehicle on the FBI's National Crime Information Center database. This way, Their bases could be covered outside of Utah if the family had already crossed state lines. Detective Maxwell reached out to family and friends to determine when they had last spoken to or seen Susan and Josh. During this process, he uncovered a neighbor named Javonna Owens who had seen Susan, Josh, and the boys both the prior day and the night before. Javonna's son Alex had watched Brayden and Charlie while Susan and Josh went to a work Christmas party at Josh's job. And the next day, which would have been Sunday, Javonna visited Susan after she got home from church. Susan had been knitting a blanket when Javonna showed up and she requested help with untangling the yarn. During this visit, Josh was in the kitchen cooking lunch, which was uncharacteristic of him. He invited Javonna to stay and he brought Susan and Javonna their lunch while they sat in the living room. He had made pancakes. While they ate and chatted, Josh cleaned up, did the dishes, and put a blanket around Susan's shoulders, a very loving and caring gesture. Susan told Javonna that she had not been feeling well. She was extremely tired all the time, and she believed she had been pregnant the month before, but had lost the baby. Javonna had been there for about 2 hours when Susan decided to go and lay down, and Josh made subtle hints that Javonna should go as well. He kept saying he was going to take the boys sledding. When she was slow to leave, he pressed her and told her once again, "I'm taking the boys sledding and I do need to lock my door on the way out." So she gathered up the yarn to finish untangling it at home and she walked out and she claimed that she saw Josh put both his children in their car seats in his car at about 5:30 p.m. that evening. Then they pulled out of the driveway and left. The next day, when Javonna found out that the family was missing, she called Josh, but there wasn't any answer. So she had her son Alex call from his cell phone. And Josh answered. Now, Josh hadn't answered any calls from family, friends, from the police. His phone had been off, but somehow his phone was on right now, and he answered it for Alex, probably because he didn't recognize the number. When Alex got him on the phone, he handed the phone to his mother, and Javonna told Josh, like, "The police are here. You guys are missing. Everybody's worried. Where are you?" This was about 5 p.m. on Monday, the day that everybody discovered they were all missing. A full 24 hours since Javonna had seen him pull out of the driveway with his kids to go sledding. He told her he was out on the Pony Express Trail and he would be home as soon as possible, and she told him to hurry. So let me put something into perspective for you. Josh and his entire family, they're missing. And his neighbor finally gets him on the phone and she's like, "Listen, everybody's missing. Like, you aren't here, Susan's not here, the kids aren't here, there's police here, everybody's worried, they've been here for hours, where are you?" And he's like, "I'll be home." And he hangs up with her and he calls his sister, Jennifer. When Jennifer finds out that Josh and the boys are there and allegedly on their way home, but Susan is not with them, she asks Josh, "Where's Susan?" And he's like, "She's at work." Jennifer gets upset with him and she's like, "Josh, Susan's not at work and you know that. Where is she?" She yells at him, "Tell me where Susan is." And he yells back, "I don't know." Jennifer realizes that her best bet is to get him home where the police can talk to him and figure out what happened. She believes in her heart that he did something to her sister-in-law. So she needs to get him home. So she calmly talks to him and she's like, "Okay, well, you know, everybody's worried. Like, we need to find Susan. Just get home." She had already left the Sarah Circle house and gone home herself, but she told him she would leave her house and go back to his house and meet him there so they could figure it all out. She drives from her house to his house again, and it's not a short drive, and the police are still there waiting, and she tells him, like, "Oh, Josh is on his way back." So they all sit there, and they're waiting for Josh, but Josh doesn't show up. Detective Maxwell calls Josh again, but he doesn't answer the call, so Detective Maxwell tells Jennifer to call Josh. Josh does answer, and Jennifer hands the phone to Detective Maxwell, and the police officer's like, "Where are you, dude? You know, we told you that we're all here waiting. Your wife's missing. We need to find out what's going on. You need to come back here." Josh tells Detective Maxwell, "Susan's at work, and I need to get my kids some food." And when Detective Maxwell tries to express to him that, "No, Susan's not at work, and don't worry about getting your kids food. We'll get them food. Come home." He ignores the detective and starts talking over him and asking the boys, "What do you guys want to eat? You know, you want hot dogs? You want hamburgers? You want pizza? What do you want to eat?" He does not at all seem concerned that his wife is nowhere to be found. And he doesn't end up getting back home until almost an hour after getting off the phone with Detective Maxwell. There was no sense of worry or urgency. As soon as he pulls in, Maxwell begins questioning him, and right off the bat, Josh is lying and acting suspicious. He says that he didn't have his phone on because he didn't have a charger and he had to conserve battery. But as Detective Maxwell's talking to him while he's still in his van, he can clearly see a cell phone charger in the car that his phone is plugged into. Detective Maxwell knew that he needed to immediately get Josh into a room and question him, and this interview was recorded, and you can hear Brayden and Charlie in the background. Josh insisted on bringing them along and then insisted on using them as an excuse every time he'd be asked a question that he didn't want to directly answer or that he needed more time to think about. He would direct his attention to his kids, like, oh, guys, calm down, or, you know, don't do that. It would give him time to think about what he was going to say next. As his answers went, they were as general and unhelpful as possible. Josh said the last time he'd seen Susan was the night before at home. He had decided to bring the boys camping in the winter at 12 o'clock in the morning, and Susan had stayed behind. He claimed that where he had been, out in the mountains, there hadn't been cell service in certain areas, and he'd shut off his phone to conserve battery. He has these long pauses between his words and sentences. But what had happened the previous day, after Susan had gone to lay down and Giovanna went home, what happened? According to Josh, he didn't take the boys sledding. He stayed home, and Susan woke up at about 6:30. She had hot dogs for dinner, and then she took Brayden and laid back down for another nap. And at that point, he took only Charlie sledding. When they got back at about 8, Josh read his son a book and put him down for bed. He claims at that point, at about 10 p.m., Susan made him use the rug doctor to clean the couch and carpet because it was dirty from the boys, and she insisted that he do it at 10 o'clock at night. Then they watched a movie, The Santa Claus 3. She fell asleep around 12:30, and Josh started to get ready for this midwinter camping trip with his two small children in the middle of the night. He said that he and the boys left the house around 1:30 or 2 and headed to the Simpson Springs camping site, and they got there around 4 a.m. According to Josh, Susan knew that they were going camping in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of December, in the middle of the night, with no tent. They have no tent. And Josh said she was fine with it. If you believe Josh's story, you would have to believe that both of their very young children had been put to bed and then woken up hours later to be put in the car and driven to a camping site hours away. And Susan was completely on board with this. The Pony Express Trail stretches nearly 2,000 miles through multiple states. It was created in 1860, and it played an important role in keeping valuable mines located in California and Utah out of Confederate hands in the days before the Civil War. Now, these are very young kids. Brayden was 2, and Charlie was 4 or 5 at the time. What mother would be okay with her husband taking the kids in the middle of the night when they don't even have a tent or anything really to go camping with? They don't have an RV. To bring her kids out, her very small children out in the elements, the cold elements, when a winter storm is coming, in the middle of nowhere to go camping in the middle of the night, I just don't understand why he ever thought that this story was going to be bought by anybody. When Josh was asked specifically where they were, what route they took, he answered with a lot of I don't knows and pretty muches, just vague enough so that he wouldn't get caught in a lie. And after camping on Monday morning, he woke up at 7 a.m., even though he'd just gotten to the campsite at 4 a.m., and then he realized, oh crap, it's Monday morning. I thought it was Sunday morning. I got my days all confused. He thought that they'd left on a Saturday, even though, according to his own testimony, Susan had gone to church the day that they'd left, the day he'd cooked her lunch, and then they left for this camping trip, and she did that on Sundays. So, but he still thought that it was Saturday. So he completely forgot that he had to work the next day, and the kids had to go to daycare and all that jazz, and he just took them in the middle of the night to go on a camping trip. Then he woke up and realized that it dawned on him after 2.5 hours of sleep. But instead of waking up and having this like realization, calling his job and explaining it, he instead built a campfire. He and the kids roasted some marshmallows, and then they drove around aimlessly for a couple of hours. When they'd had enough of roughing it, they drove back home probably about 2 p.m., and Josh claims that he stopped in Lehigh to a car wash. He didn't know what the car wash was called. He paid with cash, and he couldn't explain why he would get a car wash in the middle of a storm, but that's what he did. He also couldn't explain how Susan had gotten to work that morning, considering that he had their only vehicle. Josh said that he and Susan had a good marriage. They had disagreements, but they usually didn't escalate into screaming fights. Now, Detective Maxwell had already spoken to people who knew the couple, neighbors, friends, and co-workers of Susan's, and he knew that this was not the case, that Susan and Josh had been having a lot of problems, and he'd even gone to marriage counseling with her. According to Josh, they had gone to see someone because Susan had quite the temper, and he guessed he was kind of lazy, and it bothered his wife that he wasn't going to church. The most important thing that I garnered from listening to Josh talk that day, that night when he knew his wife was missing, is he doesn't seem concerned or worried about her at all. She's vanished into thin air. She's left behind her purse, her credit cards, her money. Nobody knows where her cell phone is. It's off. She didn't show up to work. And he's not rattled at all. And when he's asked where Susan's cell phone is because it's turned off, he says he doesn't know. He explicitly says he doesn't know where it is, and his voice never shows any emotion. His voice never escalates. He's never like, are we out there looking for her? Like, what's going on? What's happening? Because that's what I would be doing. If I was being questioned and my husband was missing, I'd answer some questions, but then I'd be like, what are you guys doing to find him? Like, where are you looking? What can I do? Like, we need to get out there. I'd be freaking out. They tell Josh that they need to look inside of his vehicle, and they have him sign a consent form, but he only signs the consent form with the realization and the condition that he can stand by and watch and stop the search at any time. And as the police are searching through his minivan, Josh settles himself in the driver's seat to wait. In the van, they found a blue plastic tarp on the floor, on the back carpet. They found a wood-handled shovel, a rusty metal rake, and a broom. There was also a humidifier and a big blue plastic tote that had some camping equipment in it. Amongst the camping equipment, something very important for camping, especially in the elements like cold or snow, was missing: a tent. There was tent stakes, but no tent. They also found a Mylar emergency blanket, a poncho, a tablecloth, toilet paper, and a multi-tool. Found in a blue toboggan next to the big blue tote was a heavy-duty extension cord, an electrical circular saw, a razor box cutter, and a folding handsaw. There was also a gas can and a gas-powered generator in the van. So good thing you've got toilet paper and a tablecloth. You can make a tent out of that. Josh Powell could make a tent out of toilet paper and a tablecloth. He can do anything. There were some blankets and extra clothes for the kids, a box of blue nitrile gloves, a camera bag, and in the center console, something very interesting was found. Underneath the top tray, hidden deep inside, was Susan's cell phone with its SIM card removed. When Josh was presented with this, he claimed that he had borrowed her phone the day before, and he must have put it into his pocket and forgot. This obviously suggests that he's lying. This was the family vehicle, so there's a multitude of excuses or reasons he could have come up with for why Susan's phone was in that center console. He could have said that he didn't even know it was there, that she must have been in the car at one point and thrown it in there and forgotten about it, and the battery died. But instead, faced with the lie he had told previously, not long ago, that he didn't know at all where Susan's phone was, to say that he'd had it the day before because he said he needed some numbers out of it, so he'd borrowed her phone, and then he must have put it in his pocket and forgotten he had it, just clearly showed he'd lied initially, and he was still lying, because if you just had it the day before and you put it in your pocket, you would have had to have some point taken it out of your pocket and buried it in that console, and that would have been recently, within the last day or so. So you would have remembered that you'd done that. The police should have obtained a search warrant for the Powell home that night, but they didn't. They didn't feel like they had enough to get that search warrant, so they didn't even try. Instead, they sent Josh home and made him promise to come back the next day to continue talking with them. He was supposed to come back the next morning at 9 a.m., and he was not supposed to bring the kids this time because they'd been a big distraction. In my opinion, sending him home that evening and not searching the house was a big mistake. When the next morning came, Josh did not show up at the police station. Detective Maxwell had called him at about 8 to remind him that he had to be there and to make arrangements for his children, but he didn't answer the call. He must have been busy. Neighbors stated that they'd seen him at 8 a.m. in his driveway with all the doors of the van open, cleaning the interior. He'd called Jennifer that morning to ask if she could watch the kids while he went to the police station, but when she got there, he was in no rush to leave. He was doing laundry and cleaning the house. Jennifer thought that this was strange. Instead of hurrying off to the police station to see if he could help the police find Susan, he was probably for the first time ever doing housework. There hadn't been a forensics team inside of that house yet, And Josh was allowed to go home and spend the night in what potentially was a crime scene and clean it, basically. He finally gets to the police station, like at noon, 3 hours later than he was supposed to, as always, perpetually late for everything. And he gets there and starts off talking about how he should have a lawyer, that he called his lawyers already, which he just had one of those online pay by the month kind of lawyer services where you can contact them and they'll help you out over the phone or online. He said he felt like it was being implied that he had something to do with what happened to Susan. He finally starts showing some emotion and like sniffling a bunch and, you know, probably trying to force tears out. And he's like, I don't know where she's at, man. He's pulling a Chris Watts, like, I don't know where she is and I'm really worried and I just want her to come home. This doesn't last long before he is back to his even-keeled, very emotionless self, and every question that he's asked, there's like these super long pauses before he's answering.
You do not know where she's at?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What do you think has happened to her? I need you to tell me what you think has happened to her.
I don't think she would leave on her own.
He's choosing his words carefully. He's trying not to get caught up in a lie. Being a fan of true crime, he knows the less that he says, the less likely it is that he will be caught saying something that will incriminate him. But he has no problem talking about Susan before her disappearance. He claims that she was depressed and suicidal. And this would start the smear campaign that Josh and later his entire family would take part in against Susan and her family. He knows that they suspect him. He knows that his alibi is weak, but he also knows if they don't find a body and they don't find enough evidence, they can't do anything about it. They tell him, okay, well, you can't go back to your house and you can't take your van. We're bringing forensic teams in to look into your van and your house. We need to do this in order to eliminate you as a suspect. Josh Powell has read his Miranda rights twice.
You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in the court of law.
And after he clarifies with them that he's not under arrest and he can leave, he gets up to go. He says he wants to think about it for a few days before continuing to talk with the detectives. And Detective Maxwell is like, are you serious, dude? Your wife is missing. These are the most crucial hours and you want to think about it for a couple of days on whether or not you want to help us find her?
You could leave anytime anyways.
Let me think about it for a couple days and...
Your wife is missing, Josh.
Yeah, but I've already...
And you want to think about it for a couple of days?
I've already answered everything. I've told you I would answer everything.
But Josh's main concern obviously is not for Susan, it's for himself. And as soon as he's read his rights, he knows they can use whatever he says and does against him in a court of law, and he's not having that. While Josh was deciding whether or not he would be staying to help find his missing wife, his sister Jennifer was driving his sons to the South Valley Children's Justice Center so they could be spoken to by someone who was trained in dealing with and extracting information from children who were potential witnesses to a crime. Charlie told these people that Susan had gone camping with them that night, but she decided to stay behind in the place with the crystals and the pretty flowers. He said this place was called Dinosaur National Park. He said his mother had been happy to stay behind because the crystals were so pretty. The place that Charlie described, Dinosaur National Park, it was obviously looked into, but no such place exists in the United States. There is a Dinosaur National Monument on the Colorado-Utah border, and the family had camped there that past August, Susan included. They had also camped at Thanksgiving Point, which had a museum of ancient life that Josh had brought the kids to. Additionally, that past May, they'd camped on the Pony Express Trail, and the kids had dug for geodes, which to a kid would resemble crystals. There was really no way to know which place or time Charlie was referring to, or if he was merging all three trips in his mind. Once Detective Maxwell has this information, however, he brings it back to Josh in the interrogation room, who's still deciding whether or not he should stay or go, and he's like, okay, so you can't go now because your son just told us that Susan went camping with you and she didn't come home. Josh could get a lawyer if he wanted, but he wasn't leaving.
One of our detectives just interviewed your children. And your children are telling our detectives that mom went with you guys last night and that she didn't come back.
She did not go with us.
I do often wonder sometimes if this was the best idea for Detective Maxwell to let Josh know that Charlie was talking and describing things and maybe remembering things to show Josh that his children could potentially be used against him, that the things that they said could be taken seriously in legal terms. I've always wondered if this was the day that planted the seed in his mind that one day Josh might have to eliminate that threat. As they got older, Charlie and Brayden would only remember more and be able to vocalize more. They figured out Josh wasn't going to crack. He denied everything, and they knew that the only way they were going to be able to build a case against him was to gather actual evidence. They had to let Josh go. According to Detective Maxwell, they couldn't have kept Josh based on the circumstantial evidence that they had. But they now had a warrant for his home and vehicle, so they were hoping to find evidence that they could use in order to arrest him and build a case against him. The forensic search of the minivan showed no signs of blood, and a cadaver dog did not react when it was brought to the van. But then again, this van, which had the previous night been cluttered and dirty, was now immaculate. All the objects that had been in it, like the camping supplies and the generator, were gone. They did find two garbage bags. One contained typical household garbage, including remnants of the lunch that Josh had made for Susan on Sunday. The other contained burned pieces of sheetrock. It was believed that Josh intended to dispose of these things after leaving the police station, not knowing that they would be keeping his van. That was why he had chosen to bring them with him instead of throwing them out in the garbage can outside of the house. As far as the burned pieces of sheetrock, the police believed that he had used the sheetrock as a base to place another object on, and then using an acetylene torch that he owned, burn whatever the object was into an oblivion. Whatever was left of this object was also in the bag, but it was burned beyond recognition. When they were done searching the van, they placed a tracking device on his vehicle. The forensic team that searched the house found tiny spots of blood on the tile adjacent to the carpet and couch. They also found a small swipe mark of blood on the couch that had just been cleaned. Upon testing, the blood found on the floor and the couch was discovered to be Susan Powell's. They discovered that the blankets that had been in the van the night before had been washed, and many washcloths had also been cleaned. 5 computers and 7 external storage devices were removed to be examined later. Detective Maxwell had also taken Josh's cell phone from him before letting him leave, but Josh had managed to remove the SIM card before handing it over. He knew this would prevent the detectives from discovering where he had been or who he had been talking to, so they had to contact his cell phone provider, T-Mobile, in order to get that information. That doesn't seem suspicious, does it, that while he's in an interrogation room, and he kind of figures out that the police might ask for his phone, he slips the SIM card out of it? Not at all. The records show that he had made a call to his father a little bit before noon on Sunday, and then the phone had gone dark. He'd shut it off. It didn't come back on again until the next day at about 3 p.m. when he received that call from Giovanna's son, Alex. When he received that call from Alex, his phone showed that he was in West Valley, just a couple of miles away from his house. But he told Giovanna that he was on the Pony Express Trail. After he hung up with Giovanna, he did drive back in the direction of the Pony Express Trail, and then he made some other calls. He called his own voicemail and checked his messages, and then he called Susan's phone and left a message on her voicemail. The voicemail he left her shows exactly how he was trying to cover his tracks. Him answering that call from Alex was a mistake because it showed that he was actually in West Valley, not down south at the Pony Express Trail, where he said he was. And then realizing that he'd picked up that phone and it might look suspicious, he drove back towards the Pony Express Trail in order to make those calls. Now, while they were searching the van, Josh waited at the police station. He didn't have a phone and he didn't have a vehicle, so he had to wait for his van to be done being searched. So he waited there. And the whole plan was that they would search his van, do the forensics, and put that tracking device on it. And then hopefully Josh would get in the van and then lead them to wherever he may have left Susan's body. But it didn't go according to plan. 10 minutes before they finished and brought the van keys back to him, Josh had left the police station. He vanished. Nobody knew where he was or how to find him. While this was all happening, the police had been to Wells Fargo and talked to Susan's coworkers, and they'd found the paper trail that she'd left. They also found her safe deposit box, which had financial documents in it. These financial documents showed that if anything were to happen to her, Josh would experience a windfall of sorts. And even if she wasn't found dead, he still had power of attorney, so he could legally sign her name to documents. A picture was starting to reveal itself. A picture of a woman trapped in an unhappy marriage. A woman who didn't trust her husband and clearly thought he was capable of making her disappear. Susan had told more than one person, "If something happens to me, look at my husband," a man who may have had a financial motive to make his wife disappear. And where was Josh? Jennifer still had Charlie and Brayden staying at her house, and she had not heard from Josh. Had he run, knowing that the police were onto him? They finally caught up to him in Tremont in Utah, where he'd gotten a new cell phone. 18 hours before that, he had gone to the airport and rented a car. What was he doing between the time that he rented the car and the time when he finally established contact with the police? No one knows, and we probably will never know. What we do know is he put 807 miles on that rental car. He claimed he had just been driving aimlessly. When the police told him to come back and get his van, Josh said he didn't trust them, that he was afraid of being arrested. The police really needed him to come back and get that vehicle because there was a tracking device on it. And what was Steve Powell doing during all this confusion surrounding Susan's disappearance? How was he feeling about the love of his life disappearing? Well, we'll talk about that in a bit. When Josh got home Wednesday evening, media vans surrounded the house. From the very start, Josh hated the presence of the media in his life. He did everything he could to avoid the cameras and the questions at all cost. He was trying to avoid the mistake that Chris Watts would make years later. Josh Powell didn't want anything that he said to be recorded on camera and possibly dissected and used against him. The search for Susan began the next morning at sunrise. 20 investigators descended on the vast West Desert. They were looking for the place that Josh and the boys might have made camp or any sign of where Josh might have left her, but in and around Simpson Springs, they found nothing. During a candlelight vigil for Susan, Josh, who was there with his brother Michael and the boys, let Charlie and Brayden's daycare provider know that they wouldn't be returning to her. His family would be responsible for watching them now. He didn't want his sons to be alone with anyone, not after what they had told the police about Susan going camping with them and not coming home. On Monday, December 14th, Josh was scheduled to come in to take a CVSA test. It's a program that detects stress in a voice, and it acts as a lie detector test. He did not show up for that. He did show up with a lawyer later, though, once the police got a warrant to draw his blood. Josh was so nervous during this blood draw that they had to constantly tell him to relax so they could access his vein. Authorities went into the Sarah Circle house with warrants three separate times, and each time they found more hard drives and thumb drives to add to the growing pile that they needed to go through and analyze. After following Josh for a while and coming up really with nothing, the police started to follow the mine lead. Remember, the year before Susan disappeared, Josh had had that uncomfortable and awkward conversation with Susan's coworker and her coworker's husband. A conversation that was so strange about how he would just dispose of a body in a mine and it would never be found that Susan's coworker and her husband never forgot it. Other friends of Susan's also came forward and told detectives that Josh had many times said that he would know exactly how to hide a body where it would never be found. And Jennifer let the detectives know that not only did she believe that her brother Josh had something to do with Susan disappearing, but that her father, Steve Powell, had an unnatural obsession with his daughter-in-law. They sent two detectives to Washington State 10 days after Susan's disappearance. Both Josh's and Susan's families lived in Washington State, so they wanted to talk to them and talk to people who knew them, but they made a beeline for Steve Powell after hearing what his daughter had said about him. It did not take long at all for Steve Powell to start talking about Susan in a very inappropriate way. Once again, this was not uncommon for Steve. He thought that his feelings and his obsession for Susan was completely normal and appropriate. In fact, most likely she reciprocated these feelings, in his opinion. So he wasn't shy to talk about how he felt with anyone who would listen. He said that Susan's faith and her religion had caused her to become sexually repressed, and that when he was around her, there was a tangible electricity about her that he was drawn to. Here's a quote from him while he's being interviewed, and he's so awkward when he talks that I couldn't get a direct quote, but I tried to get the gist. So he says, "She started that whole thing of feel my legs and sitting there on the chairs like that. You know what I mean. It was a pretty constant barrage, pretty constant. I actually confessed to her that I love her because they were planning on moving to Utah, and I did not want her to move to Utah. I hoped there was enough feeling there that she would stay. She got really upset after, and she would not talk to me for months. It was the worst thing I ever did, and it was so troubling. And after those 3 or 4 months when they got ready to move, I went over there to help them move, and she finally came out of her room. She wouldn't really talk much after that, but it was still obvious to me that the electricity was there. It's not like you can ignore things like that." When the detectives ask Steve if there was any physical contact between them, Steve says, yes, actually there was. And then he goes on to talk about the massage that happened years prior that he literally is still thinking about and dissecting to that day. He cannot stop thinking about that massage. It was like the creepy highlight of his creepy life. They tell Steve that they want to go to his house to make sure that he's not like stashing Susan there. And Steve gets so emotional and he starts like crying. And he's like, oh, she's not there. Believe me, I wish she was. He's most likely thinking of how wonderful it would be if he had her locked away inside of his house. Back in Utah, investigators were searching the West Desert's abandoned mines one by one. They started the search in secret on January 4th, not wanting to alert Josh that they'd been tipped off about the mines. They created an area to focus on that they believed Josh could have reached by car or foot, with the assumption that on foot he wouldn't have been able to carry a body very far. He was out of shape and generally just a lazy person. They used a camera with a 1,000-foot range to check into the shafts that were not stable enough for a human, which was most of them. These mines were very dangerous to explore. There could be undetonated explosives, rattlesnakes, a lack of oxygen, or any amount of unknown dangers that could be encountered in there. As they checked the mines and cleared them, they crossed them out on a map. They also had search parties and third-party companies going through the desert with cadaver dogs. No sign of Susan was found anywhere. Unlike the mine searches, these searches were not done in secret. They were highly publicized on the news, and the Powell family was intently watching. Steve wrote in his journal, I heard on the grapevine that cadaver dogs were employed, and some things were found, according to TV news, not directly related to Susan Powell. We all wondered what indirect relation the finds had to her, since the comment implied that. Something else, he writes, shows just how seriously Steve and his merry band of psychopaths were taking the search for his missing daughter-in-law. Michael has joked that Josh should make a comment like Briar Rabbit, such as, search anywhere, in the West Valley, in Simpson Springs, in Salt Lake City, but please, please don't search near Rattlesnake Rock. That's the sample of the morbid humor we indulge in from time to time. My contribution to the dark humor is it's a good thing the Mormon Church did away with polygamy. Otherwise, Josh would have had to have dug more holes in the frozen hard desert ground. Just as there's no place actually called Dinosaur National Park, there's no place called Rattlesnake Rock. So we don't know what Steve was talking about or what area that he was talking about. Outside of it being a, you know, family secret or inside joke with the Powells, once again, we may never know. The reason that Josh and his father said that they thought it was okay to make jokes and stuff about where Susan was because they thought that she was still alive, that she'd run away with another man. They told people that they believed 100% that she was not dead, she was fine, and she'd just left because she was an over-sexualized person. 12 days after Susan went missing, Josh left town. It was Saturday, December 19th, 2009. He put his sons into the minivan and he drove away from the Sarah Circle house, never planning to return to live there. And once again, as he had done so many times in his past, when he had no place else to go, he moved in with his father. The police apparently could do nothing to stop him from leaving the state, besides arrest him, I guess, which is probably what I would have done, but what do I know? Before he left, Josh had requested to withdraw money from Susan's retirement fund. He was able to legally do this because she had granted him power of attorney over that retirement fund. And there wasn't really a person in Utah, in his community, that didn't believe Josh had something to do with what happened to Susan. And that was the same case when he moved to Washington State, his community there. There was people there who knew what had happened, and they all suspected that he was not an innocent bystander. When he got to his new home, Josh started bringing the kids to church. Even though he was not a part of the Mormon faith or the LDS church, he started bringing the kids there. And this wasn't because he was trying to rediscover his faith. He was once again just finding a way to use people, because he immediately introduced himself to the bishop and he was like, yo, I'm the guy whose like wife disappeared. And oh, it's been so hard. I lost my job because of all of this and can't afford food. So he pretty much just wanted the church to financially help him out, which they did because that's what churches do for their communities. Josh was using people as he had done all of his life. At one point, while his neighbors in Utah were helping Josh and Michael pack up the U-Haul so that he could move, Josh joked to one of his neighbors that he'd just packed up Susan's head into the van. And she didn't answer. And he didn't like that because he was like, didn't she hear my joke? It's funny. And so he repeated it. And he was like, did you hear my joke? I said I just put Susan's head in the van. And she was like, yeah. Did you mean a mannequin head like she would use for doing hair, and he left, and he was like, yeah, that's what I meant. Jennifer also came by to help pack up the house on Sarah Circle, and because of a request from Chuck Cox, she wanted to grab a couple of Susan's things. There was a bench that she'd gotten for her graduation and her journals. Of course, her parents would want those things. As she was walking to her car with a box of these journals, Michael Powell stepped in her way and would not let her pass. Josh had made it very clear, nothing of Susan's was to leave with anybody but him. Was it a fear of what Susan could have possibly written in her journals? Or was it just his need to constantly have control and be able to hold those things over her family's head? Either way, he didn't give the journals to Chuck Cox. He gave them to his father, Stephen Powell. On January 13th, while Josh was having a whole new set of people help him move in to Washington State, a Sunday school teacher that had been teaching Brayden and Charlie talked to an investigator and told him a strange story. She said that Charlie had been acting up in class, and she told him if he didn't behave, that she was going to tell his mommy and his daddy. And he looked at her and said, "My mommy's dead." In August of 2011, Steve Powell went on national television, armed with Susan's journals. He read passages from these journals out loud. He made claims that Susan had been sexual with him, that she was just an oversexed person to begin with. He claimed that they had shared something special, that he was in love with her and Susan was in love with him, that Josh knew about their unconventional relationship and was fine with it. Both he and Josh gave interviews that teared apart the character of Susan Powell and her family. Josh said that Susan was extremely unstable and probably ran away with another man. When he's asked, "Well, did Susan ever cheat on you before?" Josh was like, "Not that I know of." And so he's asked again, "Well, why do you think she would run away with someone now?" And he was like, "I don't know. She was just like really sexual." Josh blamed Susan's parents for what had happened to Susan, Susan breaking and running away. He said they had put too much pressure on her. Quote, "They want her to be perfect, a saint without fallibility, but she wasn't as strong as they thought she was." Josh pointed a finger at the press as well, blaming them for his bad publicity and image, but he claimed they would move on from him to Susan soon enough, saying, quote, "She'll be chewed up like hamburger when she comes back." Jennifer responded to Josh and Steve's claims of Susan being unstable, saying it was ironic since the Powell family was actually the ones who had a well-known history of mental illness. She said she never saw Susan display any signs of instability. The search of Josh's digital devices took longer than anticipated. Not only had Josh used encryption software to encrypt some of his files and devices, but he had also used a program called Eraser, which could securely delete files without a trace. One of the hard drives they recovered was completely inaccessible. Even the Secret Service was unable to crack it. They were able to access quite a bit of information, though. They had discovered that on the early evening of Sunday, December 6th, while Susan was napping, Josh did an internet search for Ely, Nevada. He had looked up maps, weather, and he had also searched for listings for the Motel 6 and Ramada Inn. Ely was an old mining town, which would have given the police a whole new set of untapped mines to search, but it was also further than they initially believed Josh would have had time to have gone that evening, so they continued their search in the West Desert and decided to find a way to use the Ely lead to their advantage. By August of 2011, police had run out of places to look and people to talk to. It was time for some unconventional methods. Police began searching Ely rather publicly, hoping to draw Josh out to get him to do or say something which would let them know if they were hot or cold. And the way they would know if they were on the right track was by listening to his phone calls through a wiretap they had gotten permission to use. The operation was codenamed Operation Tsunami. They began listening to his phone calls on August 16th, and they made a public announcement that they would be searching the abandoned mines around Ely, Nevada. They invited the media to be there and take pictures with the purpose of getting as much coverage as they could, hoping that Josh would say something on a phone call with his father or brother and they would hear it. If Josh had in fact brought Susan's body to Ely, he would have gotten nervous and possibly, you know, showed this nervousness in phone calls, but he wasn't nervous. In fact, he did say something on the phone, and it was pretty much that the police were wasting their time there. Another event that was orchestrated in order to get a reaction out of Josh was a honk and wave that was set up by Susan's father with the assistance of the police. Tensions had been growing between Josh and Susan's family in the months since her disappearance. Susan's parents had not been quiet about their belief that Josh was involved with Susan's disappearance, something Josh referred to as a campaign of hatred and violence, and Josh had been doing everything that he could to keep Charlie and Braden from their grandparents. Josh had gone to court and accused Susan's parents of stalking him and the kids. He claimed that they'd followed him to a hardware store and ambushed him, asking if they could just hug Charlie and Braden, and he said, "No, you cannot." After this, he claims that Chuck Cox mouthed to him, "You're dead." Josh said he felt threatened and unsafe at that moment in the hardware store. He was granted a temporary restraining order against the Coxes. In turn, Chuck Cox sought out a restraining order to prevent Steve or Josh from publishing Susan's journals. What needed to happen was they needed to get Steve Powell to admit that the journals were evidence or important to the case in some way. If they could get him to admit to that on camera, legally, while he knew he was being recorded, at that point, they could seize the journals and take them out of his possession. So that's why they set up this honking wave. They basically found out where Steve and Josh did their shopping and when they did it. And Chuck set up this honking wave to remember Susan. They put pictures of Susan up, they put purple balloons, and they were just, you know, like having people honk and wave as they went by to remember Susan. But they set it up in Josh and Steve Powell's neighborhood right in front of the grocery store that they did their shopping at. So obviously, Steve Powell sees them as he's driving by and he stops. And this is a video that is going around on the internet. You've probably seen it, where Chuck Cox and Steve Powell are just standing on the street being recorded by a legitimate news team yelling at each other. And Steve Powell is basically accusing Chuck of violating the restraining order by being in the neighborhood. And so they just go back and forth. But this was purposely created so that Chuck could start talking about the journals and Steve would, in the presence of news cameras, say something about the journals and how important they were, which he did. And I'll see if I can play some clips. If they'll let me do that, I will play some clips where I show you what happened.
Why not?
Well, I just came.
Why come here today? Why not?
Well, I just came down here because we were going to get a picture of Chuck Cox. We believe he's in violation of a restraining order because Josh shops at this store, and he is not supposed to come.
I know it doesn't
mention Fred Meyer, but he knows we shop at Fred Meyer. He knows this is our neighborhood store, and that's
so
why.
So you own the neighborhood?
No. We'll have to add this.
Josh lives a few miles apart from each other.
Yeah, exactly.
So you knew he was going to be here, and you came here yourself knowing that there's a restraining order.
We wanted to see if he was here because we wanted to be able to have something to say at the hearing on Tuesday. We're having a hearing Tuesday. We weren't going to bring this up with the media. He brought it up with the media.
But you came here.
I did come here. Yes, I did. Because I wanted to see what that was going on, and I wanted
and
to
And I have one question for you. How is you coming here helping to find Susan?
It isn't helping to find Susan. How is your standing at our neighborhood market helping to find Susan, Chuck?
People see the signs, her picture's out in the media.
Right.
It's been
that
all over the media.
If somebody has seen her, then they can report to the police. And you're only going to do this. Which other stores are you doing this at, Chuck?
We're doing it in West Valley City.
Which other stores in Puyallup, other than our supermarket?
This neighborhood up here is where we're doing it. I've only got a small group of my family.
Are you doing it at the store you shop at?
I shop at this store.
Camera, and I thought
so,
I could just sneak a little shot.
Sneak a little shot.
Yeah, I did, and I got
okay.
it. Okay, that's fine. And I guess we're here,
You're
right?
You're not believable.
Yeah, right, sir. Right, I'm not. You are, though. Anyway, is there any other question that I can answer for anybody? I'm totally open to anything. I mean, we've got a lot of information about the Cox family and about Susan, a lot of it from her journals, a lot of it from Josh's, you know, he lived with Susan for 8 years before she left. He knows a lot that is not in the journals, but the journals confirm what he knows that Susan told him about her family, about her growing up years. Josh had an extensive interview with them the day or so after Susan disappeared, Erica, and the way they handled the interview, and they know they handled it wrong. They know they screwed up. If you go back to December 2009, they themselves admit there's a controversy over the reasons Josh quit contacting them and got himself an attorney. There's a controversy within, an internal controversy in the West Valley City Police.
That was because they
screwed up. And you know, as I told Josh, we should probably explain that on our website. We're not talking, I doubt that Josh will ever talk to the West Valley City Police there again, but he'll talk to the FBI. They just have to call, you know, they'll contact me if they want to. They don't tell us anything about the investigation. The only thing they told us is they believe she's alive. They've told us that. And Josh had nothing to do with her disappearance. That's what they've told us.
Then Josh gets there and he starts crying, like, I will protect my children at all costs. Okay, dude.
Josh says he spoke to detectives initially, but says he stopped because police try to make his son say things that aren't true.
They attacked my sons. I will protect my sons from anyone and everyone.
Josh kept his two boys in the car while he spoke, but then Chuck Cox's granddaughters came over.
They're just innocent kids.
And asked to see their young cousins. The deep rift in this family rose to the surface.
No, no, it's not a good time.
Okay. But after the honk and wave, some interesting information came up through the wiretap. Josh was not crying or upset when he got on the phone and called a media consultant to ask how he would be able to appear more sympathetic to the public. He was not sad. He was pissed. He was angry. He was aggressive that this was happening to him. On August 24th, 2011, because Steve Powell had publicly admitted that the journals were important pieces of evidence, they obtained a search warrant to search his home, and that search warrant was executed the next day. Steve had been called away from the house. He was 4 hours away because somebody had called him and had an important job for him to do. Once again, I believe in orchestration by the police to get him out of the house, but Alina was there, John was there, Josh was there, and Brayden and Charlie were there. So they brought everybody out of the house and they started going through the things in the house. There were computers in almost every room. Alina had 4 computers alone in her room. They retrieved some computers of Josh's and they were like, hey, you're gonna get these back a lot quicker if you tell us what the passwords are. And Josh was like, I don't remember what the passwords are. But later he was recorded on the tap telling his brother Michael, of course I know what my passwords are. I just didn't want to tell them. Anyways, Josh left with the boys as soon as he was able, but John and Alina sat outside in their yard for 9 hours while the police were inside, and Alina was on the phone most of the time, most likely with Josh and Steve, keeping them apprised as to what was happening in the house, what they were removing, etc. So what did they find in Steve Powell's house? What didn't they find is probably a better question. To say that they were pack rats is an understatement. Hoarders is more likely a better description. Bookshelves lined the walls of every room, all Steve Powell's books in there, just papers and papers of receipts and things that were irrelevant. Josh had TV screens in his room with like live surveillance of the outside of the house. It seemed like he had started on the path of paranoia shortly after getting married to Susan, but he had fully reached his destination by now. He was watching 24-hour surveillance of the outside of the house at all times. And in a locked filing cabinet of Steve Powell's room, they found the motherload of creepy things. They found Susan's clothes and underwear that he'd stolen out of the hamper. They found her temple garments, which he'd stolen out of the hamper. These were considered sacred to the LDS church. Pictures of Susan that he'd taken when she wasn't looking. Pictures of Susan and Josh's wedding, where Steve had like cut out Josh's face. The dated and sealed plastic bags that we talked about in part one of this video. Recorded videos of Susan and other women as well. And his journals, 15 notebooks full of the twisted mind of Steve Powell. In a delicious twist of justice, the man who had stolen Susan's journals to use them against her and reveal her private thoughts now had his private thoughts stolen from him. They also found a binder full of sheet music that Steve had written and produced under the stage name of Steve Chantry. I can't insert the music here. I can't find it anywhere that I'm allowed to use it, but if you want, you can go to the Cold Podcast and there is an episode, I believe it's called The Light of Seattle, where they do play some tidbits. And I do suggest if you have a strong stomach that you should listen to it because it's truly just unnerving. And it shows you the really twisted and dark mind that you're working with. I don't know if actual words exist that can describe Steve Chantry's musical genius. They're just really bad, and most of them are about Susan. Here's some of the lyrics, for example. The sun didn't shine in Seattle this morning. What did you expect? Hey, what's new? But I saw a new light turn on in me eternally the moment I laid eyes on you. The light of Seattle is you. I want to be with you. And here's a bit from a song called I'm Missing You. For the moment I begin to smell the perfume in your hair and caress you everywhere, I'm missing you. I can love you in a secret way. I can love you each and every day. There is nothing I can't see. There is nothing you can't be. It's not perfect, but I'm missing you. Oh, and these ones. You're as pretty as a doll, and I would like to play with all the things that make a little doll so nice. And you could dance, and you could sing, and you could do most anything, and I could taste your sugar and your spice. And if that wasn't enough, they discovered images of two young girls, aged 8 and 10, who lived next door to him. Steve Powell had been taking pictures of these underage young children through his bedroom window, which faced their bathroom window. In his journal, Steve happily wrote that he loved taking pictures of pretty girls in skirts at any age. Steve Powell was arrested, and that is where we will pick up next time. Thank you guys so much for being here. I am going to get this edited and up for you as soon as possible. I will talk to you very soon. Part 3 should be up this coming week. I promise it will be up before I leave. Stay kind and stay beautiful. Bye.